spread up and down. What we're going to do is we're going to send a simulated storm event into our ditch here. We've run a lot of experiments here as well as demonstrations, so we've lined it so that it won't erode during the demonstrations. You can see the leftover remnants of sediment from previous demonstrations. So picture this on your project. We've got a bunch of wattles in line. We're going to put out some ham on the wattles. And that way we will have some treatment as we go along. Now, we talked about the four ounces. And technically, I guess this is called a specimen cup. We just started using these in our research project because they're cheap. And they have gradations on them, and so somewhere along the way they got converted into a standard practice. So that's where the 4 ounces came from, because that's about what we've got here. So I'm not going to completely dose these as much as we expect you to, because I know what kind of flows we're going to get. What am I doing here? Well, I'm simulating rain so that when we put the powder on, powder will stick. Alright, so in fact, when it gets onto the wet surface, it's going to start reacting already and start releasing some of the PAM. So I'm going along raining on each of these so that it's very much like you have on your project, because before you get runoff, you have to have rain, right? So it rains for a while before you start to see runoff. So rain, and it's going to pick up this powder. And what am I not doing that you're supposed to do?
2 inches.
That's right. Half of it should be on the up and half on, or sorry, half on the up and down side and half on the wattle. And because we have a lot of sediment here, I'm not putting so much out on the up and downhill side, but if you have the fabric underneath your wattle, then you should be, where'd my bucket go? Oh, he's ahead of me. Okay. Now, one thing is, I don't know, those of you who can see this wattle, you look real carefully, right here is a good example. It feels really hard and it's a little bit shiny. That's old PAM that's sort of, gone from powder to a gel, and then it's hardened up. And then as the rain comes, it'll start to loosen up and release PAM. So that's what you look for when you're out putting out PAM. If there's still a lot of that jello looking stuff on it, then you probably don't need to put any more out. Brave like David here, you can put your hand on it and feel how sticky it gets.
Yeah,
it's very slippery. Like, I almost slipped right there. Alright, so
like salt.
Any questions about the system here? Nobody wants to ask me about how many fish have I killed with polyacrylamide? Yeah, so should be asking me how toxic is this stuff, and the answer is it's not toxic at all. Actually, very non-toxic. We use it in water treatment, so if you're on a city water treatment, you've probably got polyacrylamide in the water coming out of your tap, because you would rather have a little bit of polyacrylamide than see a bunch of sediment coming out, right? So and it's very non-toxic. It's tested. We actually did a test of how toxic it was to freshwater mussels, because that was a big question. We were recommending that it be used wherever there were freshwater mussels so that you wouldn't have a problem with sediment getting into the stream, and they're very intolerant of sediment. And our freshwater mussels are very endangered. There's not very many of them. So some of the wildlife people said, yeah, well, what are you doing to them with that chemical? We tested that. We have a freshwater mussel expert, one of the international experts on campus. He did a study, and guess what? They couldn't kill the darn mussels as hard as they tried with this stuff. They put in 1,000 times more than we would expect for treatment, for sediment, and they still couldn't kill them. They couldn't. bother them. And they tried really hard. And they were very unhappy that they couldn't kill them with this stuff. But so we've seen fish, we've seen other organisms that are tested, and they're very tolerant. So that's why we recommend using this, because you get a trade-off between a lot of sediment and turbid water getting into the creek, which we know has a very negative impact on the wildlife there, or clear water with traces, very small traces of this chemical. And I think it's pretty obvious which one is best for the environment.
Rich, on a real-life construction site, the PAMs to already be dry on the wattles before it rains, correct? Uh-huh. So it should be, somebody should be installing that or sprinkling it periodically, or?
Yeah, so you have to inspect all your devices every week or after a half inch of rain, right? So when you're doing those inspections, that's when we envision, you look, and if you can't see it, you probably need to put some more out. If you can see it, if there's still a lot of jello on there, don't bother, it's fine.
Alright.
Any other questions?
We don't use this a lot in the coastal plain, right? Mostly in the Piedmont Mountain.
Well, they should be using it in the coastal plain. You have turbidity problems there too. It's a little bit harder to attack that turbidity. As it turns out, some of the chemicals that work on pretty much all over the mountains in the Piedmont don't work in the coastal plain. So that, you just got me to another point, and that is you have to test the sediment on your project with different polyacrylamides or products, let's say, and make sure the product will actually settle out your sediment. And most companies that sell these products will do that for you. You give them a sediment sample or a bottle of muddy water. They'll test their products and say, okay, this is the one that works. Or you can do that yourself. If you've got a large operation, it might be worth figuring that out. The company that makes this particular product is out of Georgia, and you send them a sample, and for free, they will do an analysis and send you back a recommendation of their products, of course, and which ones work.
How was the cost?
Very good. That's the other. Toxicity and cost are usually the questions we get. So, depending on where you buy the product, it might cost $7 or $8 a pound. Might be a little more, a little less. If you buy train loads of it, it's $2 a pound. So a pound of polyacrylamide will treat about 120,000 gallons of water. So you don't need very much to treat a lot of water. So good question. It's really a very incidental cost to buy a bag for $300, $400, a 50-pound bag, and that'll last a project for a long time, depending on how big the project is. So, lastly, I guess I should mention that we have different kinds of wattles here, as you can see. So the first, that one and this one, these are coconut, they're coir. They will last a very long time. They're a little more expensive, but they will last probably your whole project. You've got others that are made out of, this is made out of Excelsior. I think both of these are Excelsior, which is a wood fiber, and they will last much shorter periods of time, maybe 3 months, 4 months, depending on how much flow you get, how much rain. And then we have a straw wattle down there, the next one down from this. And so that's another inexpensive product. I think most DOT projects specify Excelsior, but you might see some of these as well. And then we have some oddball products, like you see that one, you might imagine it's kind of a slinky at the end, the green one. I can't remember what that's called. Spring berm. It's called a spring berm. Really fun product because it comes all scrunched together, and then you just let it loose and the spring springs out, and it seems to work pretty well. We haven't actually tested it, but when we put it in the channel, it works pretty well. So that's another option. The cool thing about those is you can have a pallet with like 2,000 of them that's just, you know, this big, and they're all scrunched down. It's a pretty clever idea. There's lots of other products, socks that are made with fillings of all kinds of things like tire chips and compost, etc. So these are a very small number of or examples of the many different products that you can use as a check pan. All right, we ready to...
There's cups at each wattle if anyone would like to take a sample after the water. goes so over the Wattle.
So what we'll do is we're going to turn the water loose, with put some mud in it, or dirt in it, to simulate runoff. Once we get the runoff all the way through to past the last Wattle that David's standing next to, once it's going over that Wattle, we're going to have volunteers. You see the bottles around. Grab a sample, and then we'll see what it looks like. All right?
Yep.
So we're ready to roll.
On the green one down there.
Green.
Can you use the PAM on it?
Yeah, very good question. So the last one that slinky with the covering over it, it doesn't have as much surface area as you have here. So if you try to put PAM on it, it might just fall off. But you put PAM in it. It's hollow at the end. And that's what we've tried. You actually can throw it inside, and as the water goes through it and around it, it will pick it up. So, good question.
And Rich, we want to have at least one sediment control measure at the outlet before it was released.
Yeah, so we always have that. So we have a basin down there that's going to capture all this water. It's where we've ran a lot of experiments in the past, and it functions very well. So, yeah, these treatments always have to end up in a place where the sediment that's flocculated can settle out. So it may be as small as a silt fence, but mostly it's going to be a sediment basin, a skimmer basin. As you hear the water coming, if you had an example of years ago, off. There you can kind of see the treatment, especially when you get down here. See how clean the water is. So we went from